a very good noon to all the participants who have gathered here for this particular webinar on clinical research and pharmacovigilance. At the outset, I would like to thank General Secretary and Correspondent Sardar Manjit Singh Nair and Ever Motivating Principal Dr. M. G. Raghunathan for always supporting us in all the endeavors related to Guru Nanak Center for Research. Let me first and foremost welcome the guest of today, the resource person, Mrs. Alamelu, the CEO of Atria Biosciences, who has taken time out of a busy schedule to be with us today and to enlighten the students regarding research activities. Thank you so much for having accepted our invitation. And I also congratulate the organizing secretary of today's webinar, Dr. Gayatri, Assistant Professor of Plant Biology and Plant Biotechnology, for coming up with such a good topic, which will actually lead into to know about the career opportunities related to pharmacovigilance. Especially, this is a very, I wouldn't say it is an upcoming field, rather, it's a very booming field where students should understand there are a lot of research opportunities, and research interrelated with academics is going to give you employability in future. That is the very reason that we are taking up research related activities always throughout the entire year. So with these few words, I welcome all the gatherings. I can see a few staff members who have joined in. I've already welcomed. I saw the head of the Department of English, Kumaran sir, also was there. Thank you so much, sir. People are coming across the discipline to hear what actually we have in terms of employment. And thank you so much to all the participants, the students, the research scholars, the head of the department, the deans who have joined from the deans of various schools. Welcome to one and all. Now I will hand it over to Dr. Gayatri to introduce the resource person of today. Over to Gayatri.
Thank you, ma'am. I have a very pleasant duty to introduce the speaker of the day, Ms. Alamelu Moni. As the founder and chief legal executive officer at Atria Biosciences, Alamelu Moni plays a key role in developing and implementing business strategies, directing business development and recruiting top talent resources, and has created a global brand in training for clinical research and pharmacovigilance. Alamelu Murli ma'am holds a B-Pharma MBA LLB degree. She began her career at MNC. In her career of over 12 years, she has been involved in strategy development and project management roles across diverse industries such as clinical research and pharmacovigilance, education, public sectors, pharmaceuticals, and laws. This was followed by the project management and training the life sciences students at Atria Biosciences and other in-house trainings in all the top colleges across India, Singapore, and Malaysia. She is a famous personality in many TV shows for promoting career objectives in education and conducted more than 100 seminar sessions in various colleges in Tamil Nadu. She has also conducted workshops in many states in India, Singapore, Malaysia to teach key consulting, problem solving, and project management skills. Atria Bioscience is a wonderful institute accredited by the success of more than 20,000 students across the globe, and it remains wonderment in the eyes of MNC recruiters, universities, institutions, and students. Moreover, Atria Biosciences touches 10,000 placed students through training, free workshops, college seminars, and media program. That's all, ma'am. Thank you. Over to Beam, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Gayatri, for that wonderful introduction of the resource person. Now I request our resource person of today, Mrs. Alamelu, to present.
Good morning to one and all, the faculty as well as the students. Today we are going to see a very interesting subject on clinical research and pharmacovigilance. Sure. Okay, ma'am. So I just want to know, like, I'll be able to interact with the students, right, ma'am? Students will be able to answer me, right, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. They'll be able to answer, ma'am.
We have you.
Yes, ma'am.
No love. Ma'am, they'll be able to answer, ma'am. They'll be able to interact with you. They can unmute themselves and they can interact.
Sure. So I just wanted to be a little interactive so that I'll know whether they are there in this program. Can I know, like, do any one of you, I'm just addressing the students, sir. So any one of you know about what is clinical research all about? Any idea about what is clinical research? Can I have some answers? Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, my name is Vaibhav, ma'am.
So, tell me, Vaibhav.
Yeah, about clinical research, it basically deals with pharmaceuticals. When compared in a commercial aspect and in a health aspect also.
Okay. Okay.
But there are other divisions wherein clinical research not only means pharmaceuticals but also creating certain diagnostic methods also comes under clinical research.
Okay. 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 So, Vaibhav, what do we exactly do in clinical research? It's about diagnostics, pharmaceuticals, but yeah.
We search for a problem, ma'am. First, we search for a certain disease or a disorder or any abnormality. When a company
okay.
Once, and we identify that problem.
Okay.
Methods that you can have, like in not exact of the I'm not sure of the methods, but
okay. Thank you, Vaibhav. Thank you for trying, actually. If you look into the current scenario, what's happening right now, so what is it that, as he was telling, like, first look into what is the problem and then they diagnose for the entire problem. So what is the exact situation right now, all of us are in? The COVID situation is going on.
Pandemic, right? Situation.
Yeah, so we are going through a pandemic situation, and we know that there is a particular drug called Covaxin, which has been found out, which is a vaccine for COVID trials, for the for the vaccination. So what do they do? Why is it taking so long? First, they said it takes a long time to bring the drug into the market, and still they found the drug, and it's still not into the market right away. So what is the stages?
They are doing three clinical studies, ma'am, to be tested, ma'am.
Pre-clinical studies is to be testing on the animals like guinea pigs and rats, mice, everything. And after that, there is a particular situation. What right now it is going on is clinical trials. So is anybody aware of it? So after the testing of the drug into animals, on animals, we are supposed to test it on patients, record it and check whether it is safe enough without any side effects, and only then it comes into the market. So that is exactly this field of clinical research. Is everybody clear with this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Yes. I want the students to be a little interactive. Are the students there? 140 students are there in the line. I mean, at least 130 plus students. I want all the students to be a little interactive. It's not a subject, it's not a study material that you're going to learn. You're actually going to learn one of the most, you don't know that you may be landing up in one of these industries, into one of these multinational companies, and you'll be discovering a career path after the session. So just be with me a bit interactive. So this is not even about a study or a subject. This is something which everybody has to know right now what is happening, because the reason why this COVID vaccine to come into the market is taking so much time is it has so much phases it has to cross, and that is exactly what is clinical research. So we just go into this slide. So can I go to the next slide?
Yes, so
clinical research introduction. Methodical and systematic study of drugs, devices, biologics, vaccines used in diagnosis, prevention, or treatment of diseases. Like Vaibhav was explaining, you have to take it as a methodical and a systematic study of drugs. It's not about just like you can take a drug, you find a new drug, it can be brought into the market, but it has a lot of various steps that it has to be taken, and only then it comes into the market. So the major introduction will be, it has a broader aim of improving the quality of life for the patients. The next slide. So this particular trials, does it happen in one single shot? They can just test it on animals and it can be brought into the patients. Can it be done in one shot, or does it have to go through a lot of phases or stages? Is it important we need to go through
stages? No, it has to go through a lot of phases.
Yeah, so I just want a lot of interaction from the students. So why do we have to take it through lots of stages? What is the logic behind it? Can anyone tell me? We have tested it on animals, no? It should be safe enough so we can bring it to the market and test it or give it to all the human beings. Is it right to do it? Or we need to keep it like minimize numbers and then keep increasing the numbers?
Ma'am, yes?
Yes, yes. Whoever is telling me, please tell your name also and tell. Okay.
I'm allied health student, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, we can test in minimum numbers, ma'am. Then only we can able to give in it in market, ma'am. Because we want to analyze the adverse tech effects also, ma'am.
Okay. Very good. So Nirmal Khanna had a very good point because we have to see adverse drug reaction. Because a drug can be given for a particular, you have a particular symptom and we are trying to treat that particular symptom. And you don't know whether that particular drug is going to give you some kind of a side effect to what is exactly happening. So that is the phases of four types. So that is the reason they have four phases, which start from the phase one clinical trial. Is called as they test it with minimum 10 to 15 patients. So they first take it out and take the particular number of people, like 10 to 15 people, and start testing it. And that is the end of the phase one. And then once that particular report is satisfactory enough, they move into the second phase. And the second phase is starting with minimum 100 to 200 patients. And then it moves into phase three, which is minimum 1,000 plus patients will be tested. And then it comes into the post-marketing surveillance, which is called as the PISPO. The post-marketing surveillance is where the entire people, it comes into the market. And then it has been into the control of the clinical trial industry. So what are these people who are involved into this trial called as? Can anybody take part in trials, or is there any specification of these people called as? Can anybody tell? There is a picture. See, normally in a normal session, I will always tell them. It will be there in the slide itself. If you're watching the slide, you will know the name. Is everybody watching the slide?
Volunteers, ma'am.
Perfect. Okay. So they are called as volunteers. So people who volunteer to take part in a clinical trial, they are called as volunteers, and only because they have to have the correct details about that particular, like for the case of COVID vaccine, they put it on the headlines, the first person who volunteered to be a part of that COVID vaccine. So all this, if you are watching the current scenario, you will exactly understand what is the importance of clinical trials and what's the kind of opportunity, because everybody cannot go and do a clinical trial unless you have the entire technical knowledge. So that is the reason why this particular industry has a lot of technical value. Can I have the next slide? So how does this entire process of the clinical trial happen? We have the drug discovery and the development process. So the drug discovery starts with molecule identification. So the first thing we see is when we have to start up with new molecule, it's a drug discovery method. You have the molecular identification, molecular manipulation is there. So all these are starting from the molecular phase, and then you get it for the clinical research methods. So when you start it for the clinical research methods, a drug has passed through the designing part. It has come into clinical research methods. You have something called target selection. You have to select a target. Who is the target in case of clinical trials? The target for clinical trials, if suppose we have a diabetic trials happening, who is called the target? Is the subject interesting, students?
A person with diabetes. A person with diabetes.
Perfect. So for a diabetic trial, a person with diabetes is the target. So you first select a target, and then they for target identification, target validation. Right now, we are taking a particular drug which is going to test on diabetes. And is it fine that only the one criteria that he's a diabetic patient is enough, or you need to make it as target has to be identified and validated? So how do you do the target identification and validation? You have to see, suppose that particular diabetic drug has any side effects, or probably it may not be suitable for cholesterol patients. So we have to identify the target and validate the target, whether he's having only diabetics or he has hypertension, cholesterol, or any kind of an allergy. So a particular drug, so there are so many things that will be involved when they select the volunteer, and all these things steps are leading to the clinical trial process. Can I have the next slide? So the two basic methods of research in a biomedical sciences. The first one is a placebo, and the second one is the experimental research. So they try to do with the two types of research. One is the placebo. Placebo, we all know that it is like a dummy drug. There is a drug without an active component. It is just a placebo, and they also have the experimental drug. Next slide. Yeah. So it's mostly done by pharma companies. And how do they do this particular research thing? They do it by pharma companies with a very strict regulations. Can you go for the next slide, sir? So it's done mostly by research institutions, which is the entire Oriental, the organizational research. Can we go for the next slide? So this is the particular process where you have new drug development, where it has the target identification, you have the lead optimization, we have the medicinal chemistry, in vitro studies and in vivo studies. Drug development, first identify the target. So for a diabetic drug, if it is a diabetic patient, so the entire process keeps moving. You have target selection, lead discovery, medicinal chemistry is there, in vitro studies, in vivo studies. So all these phases have to cross by, and only then the clinical trials can begin. The next slide. Designing of clinical trials. So how do we all require our trials to be designed? Is it necessary? Students, do we need to design a trial?
Yes.
Why is it necessary? Any reason? Because the entire process is a very complicated thing. It's very important position. So they have to use experienced planning, proper execution of clinical trials for assessing the effectiveness of intervention. And they also have a split into planning and execution steps, which in turn provides improved success rate. Can you go for the next slide? So we have something called ICH guidelines. The stability, so the clinical trial entirely moves in with ICH guidelines, where they have to check this entire criteria of what this entire trials is all about. So they have to check on the stability, the impurities testing, GMP, carcinogenicity, genotoxicity. So all these are the particular topics on which, the basis of which a trial can be done. Students, is the subject like too technical? I want the feedback from students. Yes? Yes?
Dear, how many of you are students, there? Please unmute you.
Ma'am, it's clear, ma'am. It's very clear, ma'am.
Yeah, no, I want to know how many of the students are there with me? All of you are there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
I want students, see, I don't want it to be a very dry subject. I normally make people laugh, cry in my sessions. This is the first time I'm taking a webinar because all my trainers take for the classes and all. So when I go for a college, I make sure that it's not about a subject, it's about you. Yeah? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, you're clear, ma'am.
You're all with me? So,
yes, ma'am.
So should I tell a... particular, because I don't make a session to be, I'm not a speaker, I'm not a teacher, I'm an entrepreneur, I could make breakthroughs in lives of people. So I don't think just a subject would make the complete justice of this webinar. So do you all students like stories? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
How many of you like stories?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. After long, 2-3 people, yes, I'm hearing. Just now I feel like there's a group there. So we'll have a story of an inspiring story. I normally top up all my sessions with a story. It seems there was a particular race, like it was in a forest, and in the forest there was a race, and it seems there was a light tower. So there was a lot of bees, lot of flies over the light tower, and the lot of frogs were there in that particular forest, and all these forests, the frogs wanted to have that because they felt like there's so much of food at the top of a light tower. So why not we go and try to have food there? Because they didn't have all the water was dry, and they found that there was very less water, or there was very less food in the ground area. So somewhere this news spread. So all the frogs joined together, and all of them were ready enough to take part into a race. So they all had this, like, who's going to be the first one to go and touch the light tower and go up to the top. So as this particular race was announced, and everybody was, all the other animals were running in the sides, and they were all watching this particular frog race happening, and everybody were laughing. See, whenever you have a new dream or a bigger dream than yourself, what will people think and do? What will people do?
Laugh at us.
They laugh at us
and they discourage us, ma'am.
They'll mock at us, they'll discourage us, and putting us down. Yes. So that was exactly what was happening. And all these frogs were hearing the words of the world saying, you can't do it, this is not possible. Just imagine, you know, these little frogs are trying to even run to that end is very difficult. And these frogs are trying to go and reach the top of the light tower, and it's definitely not possible. And that's exactly what all these frogs were facing. And hearing the discouraging words and the laughter and mocks of all the other animals, one by one, every frog dropped down from the race. They slowly stepped aside. Because being a spectator in life is very, very easy. You have to be a winner. You have to be a runner. It's really very difficult what you have to do. And that's exactly what this particular thing was doing. So when this particular requirement, the frogs were all running, they had this particular, everybody were discouraging, and the frogs kept on falling out of the line. And there was one frog which was completely indifferent to everybody's words. It was not at all worried about what others were telling. It casually went to the top of the light tower, had its stomach full completely, because there was no competition. In fact, the reality of life is this: in the top, it is always free. You have very less competition in the top. Only in the beginning, you have a very high competition. And as he went up and he had his stomach full, he came down. And as he came down, everybody, all the animals were very surprised, and they were just clapping, non-stop claps, and everybody were clapping. And then they noticed something with this frog. It seems the frog was deaf, because the frog was completely indifferent. It was not worried about what these people were telling, what is the idea about what everybody is saying. He just decided he'll go to the top of the light tower. He went, had everything to his stomach full, and came back. And this is the story of whom? Is this the story of a frog? Students, is this the story of a frog? I'm not hearing any answer. Everybody is there with me. Is everybody there with me?
Ma'am.
Nirman Kana, is it the story of a frog?
No, ma'am. It's been also for us.
It's been a story of many of legendary people who have always thought that something which is impossible is not a question. It's not a language or a vocabulary of life. And this would exactly suit for almost all the students where Atria Biosciences have been attributed. And in fact, our entire institution, the way we have boomed in the last 9 years in this particular industry. I traveled to more than 12 plus countries in the last 7 months, that is till Jan, from last year till January end, just before this corona issue had come, my entire traveling was to 12 countries in almost around less than 7 months time. We expanded this organization into a global brand to 12 plus countries. And as a woman, I have 2 kids with a family and running a institution here in India. We have a very good presence. We had a team working here and I used to travel to every single country and everything was happening as like the power of a thought and power of being magnetized, because nobody could plan so many countries. Even to plan flight tickets, it takes a long time. And we had perfect projects, sessions with all the top colleges in all the top brands of institutions, including BITS Pilani to NUS, to all the top colleges, we were able to get it. And everything was this one concept, because there was never a question of what the others were thinking. It was exactly like this deaf frog who was in his mind, what was his thought, and that exactly got manifested into life. So I hope this session is not just about a subject. It's about one industry. If it can travel across the world, beginning in India, then what is the kind of potential in this market? Because the entire drug market is based on this clinical research industry, and this session can become your turning point, because you would have thought as a life sciences, you have certain limited options in life. And this session will be an eye opener for you to understand, do we have such a big, if the market is not there, if the openings are not there, potential is not there, I couldn't have grown it to a global brand. People are not going to welcome an Indian branded company or an institution to pioneer with topmost institutions. Just because there were so many opportunities, growth opportunities were there, this industry is there to offer all of us. So let's go back to the slide. I want more responses from the students. Can we have the next slide? So what is the protocol designing? The study plan formulated in accordance with the ICGCP guidelines, the standards of clinical trials, inclusion of the study objectives, study designs, inclusion and exclusion criteria. And all this is involved into protocol designing. So what is a protocol design? Do we need to have a step-by-step designing of the trials? Do we have a
need?
Yes, because every step has to be perfectly formulated in accordance with the ICH. We saw earlier in the slide, there is something called ICHGCP guidelines, which is the standards of clinical trials. And based on that only, this particular trials can be happening. Next slide. So it's a very important picture. Can you see this picture, students? Can all of you see the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. See, can you see this too? Children,
yes, ma'am.
With webbed hands. Yeah. Webbed hands and webbed feet. Right. They don't have proper formation of hands as well as the feet. And this particular disease was called as thalidomide disaster. This was the beginning of clinical trial as an industry. So what happened for this particular clinical research began was, in this particular reason, where a particular drug called thalidomide drug was given to women who had morning sickness. So morning sickness, normally they'll give Folvite in India. So that is a very small aspect of a pregnant woman where they will have morning sickness, nauseating feeling. And for children who were born to parents, the women who took higher dosage of thalidomide, this was the condition that was reported, and this happened in 1957. So this happened in US, and this shook the medical fraternity, because they said if a particular drug has been given for a particular reason, for an effect, and that drug can cause a, what is this called, a serious side effect, serious adverse event, right?
Teratogenesis.
Side effect.
It's an adverse event. Okay, it's an adverse event, which is, it's not even a side effect. It's not a small effect. It is an adverse event where the particular drug has caused a serious malfunctioning of the children. And this became the marking of clinical trials where the medical fraternity, WHO and United Nations had to decide on if we have to give a drug to the market, let us not give it based on one effect alone. So it has to be tested. Say if it has been tested in few hundred people and then thousand people, then they have a complete record that this particular drug is completely safe. It doesn't have a serious adverse event. Then it can come into the market so that we'll have a control. So the drug is just directly being tested on patients and coming into the market can cause all this thing. Diseases. Can we have the next slide? So we need ethics in clinical research, aiming at protecting the well-being of the trial subjects with the procedure of obtaining informed consent with special protection of vulnerable population. Why do we require ethics in clinical research? Ethics in clinical research is required because it has to be aiming at protecting the well-being of the trial subjects with the procedure of obtaining informed consent. Because the particular people who are taking part in a trial should have a clear understanding what is the effect and side effect of the drug, and only with that this particular trials can move on. Next slide. Regulatory affairs. So we have a position where it causes the requirements and guidelines to undertake clinical trials in India. So there is a very controlled situation. They have the code of federal regulation for the submission of IND and NDA applications. They have the global regulatory process for the initiation of conduction of clinical trials. So you can look into the picture where it is costing regulatory affairs, project planning and management marketing. So the entire world has important health professionals and regulatory affairs, and only based on that a particular clinical trial can be conducted. Next slide. So there are a lot of Indian medical organizations. When it comes to India, India has a lot of procedures which it has to be following, from the Ministry of Health to CDSCO to the Drugs Controller Act. So all this has to be followed, and only then the trials will be conducted. Next slide. We have an industry called biostatistics. It's not just an industry where you have a few things. See, when we see this, clinical trials is there, clinical data management is there. We saw an industry called regulatory affairs is there. And this is a particular industry which is called as biostatistics. So what is biostatistics? Anybody can give me the definition of what is biostatistics? Study designs. Finalized in the
statistics of biological data.
Yeah, exactly. So we are already involving what? Biological people. We are involving people, study of people is happening. So you involve with this particular statistics. So the study designs finalized in the protocol, like parallel design, crossover design, and the techniques of randomization and blinding. And you also have the statistical significance in sample size for appropriate results. So this is what happens in the biostatistics department of clinical trial industry. Next slide. We have the bioanalytical bioequivalent studies. Bioavailability and bioequivalent studies to establish links between different formulations used during the development of a new product. So there is something which starts even before the clinical trial happens, which is called as bioavailability and bioequivalent studies, which is used to establish links between different formulations used during the development of a new product. Therapeutic equivalence. That is when any new drug comes, they will actually check the bioequivalence value of that particular drug, which is in comparison with the current industry. The next slide. So this is an example of how the bioequivalence studies happens. Next slide. Documentation. It's a particular industry or a that is a, itself a particular designation they call this, and it is called as preparation of case report form, CRF, the role of clinical research associate in a powerful documentation of trial documents, and also the role of CRO, the contract research organization, in completion of cases. So we have something called, do we have a need of documenting all these clinical trials? Is there a need? Yes, Hemal.
Yes, ma'am. Why should we it do is it? Needed.
It is needed. Why should we do it?
It is an ethics, ma'am.
It is an ethics, but do we have a specialized documentation software? Do we use a specialized software? Yes. Is it important to use a specialized documentation?
Yes.
Yes. What kind of a documentation is required? Is there a particular software?
SAS, ma'am.
Perfect. It is SAS. We have one.
Even Python also, ma'am.
Through Python also they do SAS, statistical analytical software, and this entire software that has been connected is called as clinical data management. Pharmacovigilance, the post-marketing surveillance of the drug after successful clinical trial report enhances improving the quality care. So the adverse, so you can see the picture, it shows you a small thing which mentions side effects, that is like of the drug. It just shows you the exact picture where there's a lot of trials going on, everybody is happening, and there is one thing which they report, particularly the adverse event reporting through appropriate forms and adverse event codes, that is MedDRA coding, the process of signal detection. So when anything goes wrong in any part of the trial which happens across India or the world, there is a particular process by which the signal detection happens. I'll show you how the CDM has all been interconnected, because it's happening across the world. Like right now, the global pandemic is happening. Trials are happening in Russia also, India also. Everywhere vaccine trials are happening. And anywhere a particular detection of an adverse event. Adverse event is what? Something which is very serious, which is not expected. It's not about a nausea or a hair fall or smaller thing, but something like a heart attack or epilepsy, something, an adverse event will happen, and that will be immediately coded through the process of signal detection. Next slide. We have the Central Drug Standard Control Organization in New Delhi. You can see the Uppsala Monitoring Center, and all these is the flow of ADR reports. So they check from the entire segment, from the committee of health committee to ADR's monitoring center to the patient's healthcare. So everywhere it is being monitored. Next slide. Clinical data management. The answers from the clinical trials regarding the efficacy and safety of a drug depends on the quality of data, including the approval marketing. So the CDM consists of processes such as trial data acquisition, validation, integration, and database administration. You can look into the picture where there is one centralized data management, and it's like a server room. So one server is there, and entire clinical trial, the computers are being connected to that one trial document. And this is how the entire market happens. The answers from the clinical trials regarding the efficacy and safety of the drug depends on the quality of data, including the approval marketing. So it will involve acquisition. The first part is they have to get the data from all the places. They have to validate the entire data, integrate it. The database administration happens. The backup security happens. Next slide. The clinical research background. The clinical research jobs are amongst the most sought after job segments in the healthcare industry, with over 40% of new top job offerings. So if you look into the, these are the last few slides that we are going in towards the end of the session. So what is a clinical research background? Do we have a lot of opportunities in this industry? Students, do we have a lot of opportunities?
Dear participants, you can unmute yourself and answer when ma'am answer, ask some question.
Participants, can you tell me, like, do we have a lot of opportunities for clinical research background?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So what are the different designations we can enter into? Like we saw right now, what are the different designations we can enter into? Can anyone tell me?
I'm data manager.
Okay.
I'm research scientist.
Okay. Clinical research associate, we have. CRA position where you'll be conducting trials on human patients. We have the clinical data management, which will be into the document management industry. Apart from that, what else? We saw something called bioanalytical bioequivalence, right? Students, we see something.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So bioanalytical research associate, there is a designation called that. And we have the pharmacovigilance, we saw. Right. For the PV, we have for the pharmacovigilance, it is pharmacovigilance industry. And we also have for clinical data management, SAS, analytical software, SAS programmer positions. So the clinical research jobs are the most sought after job segments in the healthcare industry with over 40% new top job offerings. And there is a major gap in demand and supply of trained manpower. What is the most important quality or thing that you have to in? Is it a degree, a graduation from a college is enough for you to get the job? Students?
No, ma'am.
Can anyone hear me? Yeah. So what do you have? You need to be the most competent in the market, right?
Competent. No, ma'am.
You need what? Yes, you need what? A proper training in. Very important. You need to have the
proper
exposure
training,
exactly to
experience.
What the market requires. See, you can't go suddenly. You can't take an experience and go. You need an entry into the industry. And what are all the important industries? After this session, I would request all of you to go and check on the net. What are all the opportunities available in the clinical research industry? How big is this market? Is it really a big market that so many? And this is coming new to you. And right now, just to see. A pandemic happening across the world, and if this is the situation where any new drug has to be going through the clinical research industry, what is the kind of market potential in this particular industry? And there is a gap in demand and supply. Demand is high and trained manpower is there. Graduates are there, life science graduates are there, but there are not much enough people who are being trained into this clinical trials. With the shift of work to India, we have a lot of new players coming in. And the demand of companies are very high. Can I have the next slide? India is the major hub for clinical research. India is one of the top three countries where companies plan to spend the most R&D dollars over the next 3 years. Favorite destination. Why is India called the hub of clinical research? Can anyone tell me? For doing trials, what all do we require? We need patients, right? Yes, students.
Yes, ma'am.
What answers?
Yes, ma'am. We need patients.
Volunteers.
We need diseased patients. We need medicines. We need hospitals. We need healthcare professionals. We need clinical data management companies. You know, IT companies is also required because all the trials is happening in the hospitals. The data management pharmacovigilance has to happen in the hospitals. So all this has to be there in one place and it has to be cheap. Does everything suit into India? Right. That's what we are seeing in this slide, where we have more than 200 plus hospitals serving as sites for clinical trials. And India is emerging as one of the fastest recruiter of subjects across the world. And all the top medical universities are there in Asia. The next slide. India's vital clinical status. You can see the status of India, which is having from cancer to diabetes to HIV to epilepsy to hypertension to schizophrenia. So all these are in million, and all these are lifestyle disorders, not diseases. So these are all disorders where once a person gets for a lifetime, they continue to have. And this is the kind of market, and hence we need this particular. Clinical trial is a very important part. So even across the globe, they invest on India as a clinical trial hub. So we get more opportunities.
Ma'am, even cancer is a disorder, ma'am.
Cancer is also I'm talking about a disorder. It's a lifestyle disorder. No? I'm talking about disease means if you have malaria or a typhoid. I'm talking about the time duration of a particular disease. So almost all these diseases are at least minimum 5 years, 10 years. Once they come, it takes at least many years. So the particular patient will be taking the drug for a long time, right? it's a disease.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, yes, ma'am.
It's not a short-term disease. It's all a disorder. It's like a lifestyle disorder. Cancer happens because of a lifestyle disorder. Diabetes happens because of a lifestyle disorder. It is not coming just because one day one animal, one organism has come. It has been eroding, no? I'm talking about in that terms. So it's for long term. So hence, the particular drugs have to be given to the patient for a longer term. Trials happen for longer duration. Next slide.
Yes, ma'am.
Next slide. Can we have the next slide? Yeah. The clinical research career pathway. So where all do we get the jobs in clinical research? Pharmaceutical companies, clinical CROs, BABE centers, SMOs. We have it in the site management organizations, the data management CROs, the IT companies, central laboratories, and packaging and contractual. All these industries, this particular careers are available. Next slide. Why do we need a career in clinical research? It's the fastest growing segment in the healthcare. It has excellent opportunities to develop combination of technical and management. You want to work in wet lab trials, you can go and work in wet lab. If you want to work in the dry lab where you want to have a system base, currently the situation, everybody's looking for a job where you can do work from home option. The CDM and pharmacovigilance is completely work from home option. None of our students have ever lost the job during this pandemic because everything is perfect. Trials is going on, data management is going on. You don't have to step out of your house. With your own system, you're going to do the CDM PV. So that is the kind of market potential. Have attractive compensation, future growth, higher job satisfaction, continuous training opportunities, and international opportunities. Next slide. So that was the end of the session. So do we have any questions? I think we're sharp by one to finish the session. So do we have any questions?
No, ma'am.
So was it clear to everyone?
Ma'am?
Was it clear to everyone about this industry?
Yes, ma'am, clear.
Yes. I would prefer to take up with your mail IDs and your details. We can send this entire details for people who are interested to pursuing this as a professional course or a PG diploma as an add-on or even a certification courses we have, so that you can have an entire knowledge, take a professional certification and also a professional support for your placements.
Ma'am, if you don't mind.
Yes.
Can I read out the question post in the chat box?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
It is asked by one Ms. Acharya Anisha that, ma'am, okay. Do you advise students to take SAS programming course?
Okay. See, it depends on Anisha. SAS is a completely software related part, statistical analytical software. So you'll be able to join as a clinical SAS programmer. But ideally, my suggestion would be to take up like a diploma into clinical research, CDM and pharmacovigilance, in which SAS is one part. So that you are open to CDM also, because if you take only SAS programmer, you will not be eligible to enter into clinical data management. So ideally, a diploma course into clinical research and CDM will entitle 1 month of SAS insight, so that you will become a much better candidate. You can enter into clinical data management as well as into SAS or even pharmacovigilance. So that will be much better for you. Individually taking SAS alone, you're again going to constrain your opportunities. Only for SAS programmer you will be eligible. The market potential for SAS programmer is little lesser than compared to clinical data management. So take up to a diploma course where it will cover also SAS, so that you have more opportunities. The entire idea is you have to have at least 4-5 destinations to enter in. So that even if you join for CDM and then you feel, no, I want to go and work in a wet lab research, I'm not much with it. With the computer part, then you will have options to shift. Any other questions?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Another question, but I think from Hemal Bala, but I think you've already answered it. What are the qualifications we need to take it up as a professional course?
Yeah, that's what. All life science candidates, any life science candidates, you can proceed with the this particular industry. That is for a BSc biotechnology or an MSc biotechnology. I'm talking about doctor from an MBBS to a BDS to a B pharmacy, M pharmacy, pharmacology, PhDs. to MSc Biotechnology. Everybody, this particular course will be there. And only thing is the difference, because the market is very big. You have starting from a CRA to CDM into pharmacovigilance into drug safety physician. So depending on what is the qualification and what is the course they take, it depends on the package and their designation changes. They will be entering into the industry, but with different designations.
So one Mr. Ajay has asked, what are the best institutes to study clinical data management abroad or in our country?
There are many institutions. One thing is where have universities to study for MSc clinical research. It's like a 2-year course. So we have many universities which takes for the very couple of universities, not much of universities, which takes for MSc clinical research. But ideally, suggestion would be either a 6-month course or a 3-month course would be more than sufficient. A PG diploma and diploma in clinical research will be more than sufficient. You have to choose on an institution which gives you with the placement support, because it's not about the study. We don't require another degree or a diploma certificate, but you need a very aggressive backup regarding for the placement. And Atria Biosciences would be the right choice, because it has been one of the most affiliated institution where the entire focus is regarding the placement part. We would like to get trained and have experience, ma'am. So what are the availabilities? So Fanindra, that is what, when you take up training, you get in as internship. That is like when you take for CDM and pharmacovigilance, we'll be training you on the real-time software itself and simultaneously providing you for the interviews. So how many of you are in the final year? How many students are from the final years?
Ma'am, around for life sciences, each life science has around 50 students per class, ma'am. So if you're talking about UG, it will be 150 students. And then for PG, it will again be 20 to 30 students. 100. So a total of 180.
They're all final years, ma'am?
Yeah, 180, ma'am.
180 students, yeah. So I'm specifically speaking about, in fact, second year, third year, you have to start thinking on your direction of your, because today the market is 10th standard student has to start studying from 8th standard, planning on what is going to be his 11th course. Right now, you're all there in the college. So ideally, like how the IT students take up with the Java course and all that during their college beginning itself, you must choose on the right industry. And because you don't have to think right now whether CRA is good for me, CDM is good for me, ideally take a course which covers all the three. So that you will be having open opportunities when you attend the interview, because all this is are all interlinked. You should have the knowledge of all the three subjects together. So get into a couple of courses, preferably for college students. I would suggest 3-month course where which covers all the theoretical and practical, which has enough requirements to get into a multinational company. So when you enter into that, you get the entire exposure, get exposed to the interviews which will give for both CRA, CDA, PV. Then you will be in a position to choose which position to enter in, because all the three will be trained.
Yeah, Mr. Arpan Bose has asked, can all the students can also do it? Of course, you have answered the question. Any life sciences students can take this up. And there is one question from Dr. Shivakumar asking that, does medical coding come under clinical research?
Shivakumar, medical coding is a completely different market. Okay, clinical medical coding is something where in the abroad countries, the doctor will not write a prescription. They have a part, because as the doctor will come and work, he will give an oral prescription. That is, he will just dictate the particular recording. This is the diagnosis. This is the particular situation of a particular patient. So the entire diagnostic reports of US, UK, all the hospitals, the doctor doesn't have time to write. So he will just dictate. Everything will be orally recorded. And that particular data or the voice recordings of the doctors of diagnostic report are being coded here in India, which has been the reports. So you are actually telling the medical reports of a US patient. That is just a translation. A voice recorded is been written in English. That's the medical coding. Clinical trials is you're going to conduct trials on human patients. That's a new industry. So it is nowhere relevant to medical coding. We have one term called MEDRA coding and clinical trial. That is also different. It's about clinical data management. So don't enter into medical coding or medical transcription, which are all outdated. You have to look in where right now there is huge opportunities, and it's also having a very fast growth opportunities.
Ma'am, Ms. Danisha has asked, is there any reliable science or databases for clinical researchers?
Danisha
has asked, is there any reliable sites or databases for clinical researchers?
I'm not able to understand. Reliable?
Sites or databases.
Okay. For, see, you don't have to go and read about clinical researchers. You have to see about what is the job opportunities in clinical trials. You can see as clinical research organizations. What are the top clinical research organizations in India? You don't have to read about clinical researchers. Each one is a person, is a doctor or a physician is going to work as a clinical researcher. You can just check about clinical research organizations. You can get as much knowledge on CROs. Like all the pharmaceutical companies are having clinical research organization. You can check on that. And somebody was asking me whether there is online courses. Right now, generally itself, we are one of the best online courses. We have the best Skype classes. And right now, since because of the pandemic situation, the entire process is also online trials. We are training on online Skype classes. And the placement is also happening as work from home options. So for final year students who have got till their previous mark sheets, you can take up with the course and you'll be able to join with the MNCs even at this stage. Because I know the course completion certificate is not being released from the colleges, but still the companies are recruiting based on the previous mark sheets. Just with the NOC from the college, you can start working from home. And once you get the college certificate, then you can start working directly with the companies.
There are a few people who have actually told that it is a wonderful presentation that you have done. I'd like to read the comments from Mr. It's an excellent and energetic, enthusiastic and engaging presentation, and he has actually congratulated you on that. And one, Mr. Hemal Balla and Nirman Karna, they have asked about the courses that are available with the Atria Biosciences, and if you could share your email ID. So if you could.
Sure. I would prefer to take up the mail IDs, ma'am, from you so that I can share with them, because we have a lot of useful information. Like they are asking, they need to get a lot of information. I have a multiple interviews given in Tamil and English and a lot of informative information. So I can give you a professional links. I can send the students also all the links. I can even share it to ma'am, Gayatri ma'am. So she will be sharing to the students. As far as the course fees is concerned, we have the 1 month certificate, which is the fee structure is 30,000, and we have the 3 months diploma, which is 60,000, and we have a very lucrative discount offers when it comes with the college tie-ups through the college seminars when we get the students, because we encourage the set of college students final years who are trying to come in. So the fee structure for the 1 month course both has with the 50% discount. 1 month course comes in 15,000 and the 3 month course comes in 30,000. And the most important part is, like, since our entire institution works on the placement part, we have a very easy, flexible installment payment. So you can pay partial installment and do the enrollment, take the classes, attend the interview, and you can do the balance payment once you receive the offer. Since the entire course has been concluded with the course, with the placement. Yeah.
Dr. Mahalakshmi Prabhakar has asked, can our students do this course while during the graduation period?
Definitely, ma'am. Definitely they can do it. That's what I'm telling. I'm encouraging the students. It is better that they do it through the online when they can take up during their final year colleges itself. Ma'am.
Yeah. Ma'am, I guess you have answered all the questions pertaining to the participants. Let me formally congratulate you on this wonderful webinar that you have given. Thanks to you for having accepted our invitation and having been with us today, with our students, with our research scholars, for making them understand that there is a wide opportunity available to all the researchers out there, especially in terms of clinical research. There's a vast area, and instead of us sitting saying that there is a lockdown happening, you can always utilize this time to go into online and learn a lot of things. And one such big area is going
and
to be clinical research.
They can take it online, they can start working from online. Finally, your students don't have to think because we have placed so many thousands even during this lockdown period, because finally students, the companies are accepting because trials is happening and data management is going on. So they can take it online, they can start working, also work from home. And then once the exam parts come, they can finish the course there. So it will be like they can, they don't have to wait for their job opportunity.
Ma'am, where to apply, ma'am?
You have to enroll for the course actually.
Okay, ma'am.
You're asking about where to apply for the job, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. See, because you have to apply for this clinical research companies, and the companies will not recruit people who are pure freshers. They need a like we saw this entire ICGCP guidelines to clinical data management part, everything. So you need to enroll for the course. You can take our details. Ma'am, I would like to share my contact number, ma'am.
Ma'am, issue. See, participants, all the details and the PPT and everything will be sent to the registered mail ID. So do not worry on that. Ma'am,
you can also share my... Yes, ma'am. Yeah. You can also share my contact number, the 8838 number. You can share to them so that they can coordinate with me. You can share your CV also in the WhatsApp so that I can guide you personally. We have a team, so our HR team will guide you personally.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. I think that is it. Participants, any other questions, or we can wind up the session, I think. See, again, I would like to say to you, the very reason the Guru Nanak Center for Research is hosting such program is to bring students into research. We have a, madam, for your information, we have a student research club attached to our Guru Nanak Center for Research. Under this banner, we are bringing in undergraduate students and postgraduate students and MPhil scholars and research scholars for them to understand interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary research, for them to understand the research is, has to have some social relevance so that it goes and reaches to the public. And this is the reason we are bringing out different topics for our students to understand. They, now we are also going to start on humanities also. So I think this session was very, very beneficial to our students for them to understand, because many of the live students have joined here today. They will have understood the importance of clinical research. Thank you so much, ma'am, for having accepted our invitation and being here to give a briefing on clinical research and the opportunities available in clinical research. I thank our principal. I thank the organizing secretary, Dr. Gayatri, for this wonderful program. I thank the deans who have come, especially the dean, Dr. Noorjahan, who's here throughout the session to support us. Thank you so much, Noorjahan, ma'am. And thanks to all, Dr. Mahendra Kumar, Dr. Mahalashmi Prabhakar. I'm sorry, I just couldn't see the names. Dr. Amal, sir, who always supports Mr. Amal, sir, who always supports us in all our endeavors. Thank you to all the research scholars and the students who have taken the time to be here. Thank you one and all.
I would like to thank Gayatri ma'am's support. It was her persuasion that she made me take this session. Had a very wonderful time with all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Want to know more about these topics? Please follow us at Guru Nanak Center for Research YouTube page, Facebook, Instagram, and don't forget to subscribe our channel. Thank you.